Welcome to the Edge Show number
87.
You got it, 87. So,
now, and it's not like 187.
We were arguing like technically because I was supposed to have episode 86, but then he took it because I was late publishing. So either way, welcome back, new year. 87 is here.
That's right.
We have a couple of news items. And a special stuff that we're going to be doing on the next episode as a teaser.
That's right.
As a teaser, but I can confirm that there is something that's cool going to happen on the next episode, so stay tuned for that.
Something, maybe something or someone.
It might require that you get translation software on your PCs to be able to understand it, but you know, we'll see what happens when we announce this sort of stuff coming up next episode, so stay tuned, number 88.
That's right. Anyway,
that's cool,
so the news.
Oh,
yeah,
the news.
Hybrid cloud, best practices for operating your hybrid cloud, planning, deploying, managing. Hybrid cloud, we have a new blog post series on In the Cloud. Yeah. You definitely want to check that out.
Yeah, Brad Anderson's been doing some really cool stuff on this blog called In the Cloud, on the Microsoft blog from the TechNet platform. And this is number four of a, I think it's a 9-part series he's doing. It's crazy.
Yeah,
he likes those 9-part series.
Yeah, it's, well, you know, there's, you got to go into depth. So it is good because, you know, if you are wondering what are some of the different connection pieces to resources, things you're interested in, and either going from on-prem to the cloud, you know, with Azure, there's technical resources for learning bits for you to kind of get started to go deeper into the different areas. Mm-hmm. A lot of people, hybrid cloud means a lot of different things to different people and different parties as well, right?
Yep.
So if you're outside of Microsoft, right, some people say, oh, hybrid cloud, we've got a VPN that connects you up. And it's like, well, no, we have a bit broader vision than that. Yeah.
A bit more broad than that.
Yeah.
So in this particular post, he's going through things like health monitoring, so overall maintenance and running of your cloud.
Yep.
Health monitoring, also covering things like self-service capabilities, being able to do stuff for your users, and also a level of automation as well.
Right.
So he like his other series, has basically gone in and ties off to a bunch of other technical blogs written by the engineering team that he runs about different things. And I know that, for instance, these guys here, we're fans of these guys on the Building Clouds blog for deployment for the PDT software.
Yep.
They got some good stuff on there for how to do things.
And there's an MVA series that's up and coming around that as well. So if you want to have the video version of that with demos and whatnot, then
check it out. MicrosoftVirtualAcademy.com.
That's right.
Please turn down your phone over there in the corner. We're trying to record here. No problem. next up, we have basically a best of 2013, kind of a mixtape deal, as I like to call it. So prior to the break, if you had seen the show that was not quite the show that now is being replaced by this one and this way and that way, ask the PFE, Premier Field Engineers blog, has a nice post that basically summarizes their best topics for the entire year.
Yeah.
That they have covering a whole variety of topics.
Yeah, for those of you who don't know what PFE or Premier Field Engineer is, those are the people that go on site, do critical on-site support and consulting.
Were a PFE.
I was. I was one of those guys quite a while ago, from my pre-evangelist days.
When he was younger and still very wet behind the ears.
What?
You're a young guy, man. I'm the old man here. You're the young guy.
I don't have a hat, though.
That's true.
That's
because you have hair. Look at that hair.
Yeah. but anyway, the Ask PFE blog is a good one to go to for like specific technical nuggets of wisdom, right? And in very great areas from guys who are out there doing it. Seeing a lot of the top issues, and you know, you can pull up some tips there.
Like if you take a look here at the mixtape that they have, like it's going to jump out at me here is the Hyper-V 2012 best practices in a checklist form, upgrading your AD to 2012, different phases, phase 1, 2, and 3 for assessment, planning, and deploy. For doing some upgrade stuff. And also, the one I always get is a debate between our EFS and NTFS, when to use one or the other. So really good stuff in there, some great articles, a great little summary to catch up and some reading for your technical browser, and a good summary of what happened over the last year.
Okay, well, what else do you have here?
Well, the interviews, oh, I hit the wrong one. This is what I want to hit. The interview segment that I have lined up for us after the break is actually one that we have announcing the Linux integration services for Hyper-V, which works in this edition is version 3.5, so it works in 2012 R2, and brings an even greater feature parity for capabilities to your Linux boxes, as well as what you'd normally expect to have for your Windows boxes.
Yeah.
And so I have Abhishek Gupta, one of the main PMs for the Linux Integration Services team is on to talk specifically around some really cool stuff for dynamic memory support, dynamic disk expansion and contraction support, and obviously integration of these different things into different flavors of Linux, as well as BSD as well. Mm-hmm. So he's got the post that came out on January 2nd that basically lists them all off. Ben Armstrong was the one that actually posted it, but he's the one that wrote it, including links to download, and then a nice summary of what the major feature set happens to be. But then he goes into a much longer detail of the actual demos, all the nitty-gritty about the different versions of stuff and everything else in the segment coming up just after the break and after the news.
So if you are a person that is a Linux type of folk that likes to run that on System Center / Hyper-V, you'll definitely want to check this out, mm-hmm. and then you know ask those questions on the bottom of the post here.
So after the break, come on along and come back. We're going to go take a look at Abhishek's interview right after this, and hope you enjoy it. Hey, it's Rickster CDN from The Edge Show, and I've got with me today Abhishek Gupta. Is joining me in studio today to talk a little bit about Linux Integration Services. Is that right?
That's correct. So that's correct, Rick. I am a program manager in Microsoft's Open Source Technology Center.
Okay.
And I am one of the guys who's interested with ensuring that all open source operating systems run extremely well on Microsoft's virtualization technologies such as Hyper-V and Windows Azure. And as you mentioned, today I'll be talking a little bit about what infrastructure is available to run Linux and FreeBSD on Hyper-V.
Now, we met virtually, I don't know if you remember this, but we met virtually because I saw you make some comments on one of the blogs that came out of Brand Anderson's post way back in September timeframe for the Cloud OS Pro and stuff like that. So thank you very much for taking the time to join us here in studio and talk a little bit about stuff.
It's a pleasure.
So you mentioned open source technology, open source operating systems, first class citizens on the Hyper-V platform as an example, or the Microsoft platform. So you know, what exactly are we doing? Like, what are integration services for Linux, I'm assuming, and also for BSD?
Sure, great question. So as you may have heard, Hyper-V offers two types of devices. Mm-hmm. One of the type of devices is the emulated devices, and the other type of devices is the synthetic devices. Now, synthetic devices allow users to take advantage of better performance and a much better feature set on top of Hyper-V. So Hyper-V exposes certain services via these synthetic devices that allow virtual machines to run in a more performant and more feature-rich fashion on top of Hyper-V. And we write these services for different operating systems such as Linux and FreeBSD. Mm-hmm. So the collection of these services and drivers for a given operating system are known as integration services. Linux has its own set of services. FreeBSD has its own set of services. For Linux, they are known as Linux Integration Services. For FreeBSD, they are known as FreeBSD Integration Services. And Windows virtual machines have their own integration services.
Mm-hmm. So how is it, do they manifest themselves differently for the Linux model versus the BSD model?
That is correct. So the services or the drivers which are required to run these synthetic devices, they are developed keeping the Linux device driver model in mind. Mm-hmm. And the ones for FreeBSD are written with keeping the FreeBSD device driver model in mind. So each of these services are written specifically, tailored specifically for that operating system, for whichever operating system you're writing it for.
Okay. So how about Linux distribution? How are you supporting the Linux distribution process?
Right, that's a great question. So, you know, one would think that if you have certain device drivers, if you need certain device drivers to run on a platform, they should come built into the operating system. But often sometimes that is not the case. You know, when 5 or 6 years ago when we started this project, our drivers, our services were not included into the Linux kernel or the FreeBSD kernel. So what we went about doing was that we developed the code for these services so that Linux and FreeBSD based virtual machines can run well on Hyper-V. And then we created binaries for them. We packaged the whole code into an ISO file and shipped it via our TechNet download pages. Okay. From there, our customers could go and download the binaries, install them on their Linux virtual machines, and run them. But over time, as our drivers matured, they became part of the respective kernels. So our drivers are now part of the Linux kernel. They're also part of the FreeBSD kernel. Now, on the Linux side of things, I'll first talk about the Linux side of things because we went in that direction before FreeBSD services came into existence. Mm-hmm. And So for Linux, what we do now is that every time we add a new feature to Linux, we check it into the upstream Linux kernel. And from that kernel, different distributions download the source code and package it into their upcoming distribution releases, which are directly delivered to the customers. So customers do not have to download a Microsoft ISO anymore. They can directly obtain the services from the distribution releases, from the upcoming distribution releases. Now, the advantage of this is that, as you can imagine, is that the support, which if customers need some any kind of support, they can get that support directly from their distribution vendor.
Mm-hmm.
So, in this chart, as you can see, you know, we are delivering Linux integration services directly via distributions. But then support issues, if customers have any support issues, they can first go to their distribution vendor and have it sorted out. And then if the distribution vendor cannot sort it out, then they may leverage the Linux community to sort the issue out where our developers are present and they are listening to any feedback that customers might be giving. So this is a model which we have been proposing, and it is already working for us in the Linux community.
Mm-hmm.
And we are trying to develop the same model for the FreeBSD community.
Okay. Now, from a Linux distribution perspective, the question I get asked an awful lot is which ones are supported? Because there are so many different variants of what's out there. So what specific distros do we support?
Right, this can always get confusing. And you know, we try to support the most popular Linux distributions that are out there.
Mm-hmm.
I'm very proud to say that we have a very wide variety of distributions we support today. We support Red Hat Enterprise Linux, we support CentOS, we support Ubuntu, we support SUSE Enterprise Linux Server, we support Debian, and recently we have started supporting Oracle Linux as well.
Okay.
Not just that, we support one SKU in each distribution. As you can see, you know, we have a wide variety of SKU support across distributions.
Mm-hmm.
For example, for Red Hat, we support everything from 5.5 to 6.4. For SLES, we support 11SP2, SP3. For Ubuntu, we support 12.04 mm-hmm. all the way to 13.10. And similarly, you know, for Debian, we have support for 7.0. So we have a wide variety of support. On older distributions that were released before our drivers got integrated into the kernel, we still have binaries available through our TechNet pages,
okay.
The ISO I was talking about.
Yep.
But for newer distributions, such as, you know, SLES 11 SP3 or Ubuntu 13.10, 13.04, customers already find that the drivers are already integrated mm-hmm. into the distribution releases.
Now, if I remember correctly, we chose these versions because they're the most prevalent ones that are used in enterprise environments, most likely going to be used for enterprise-type solutions.
That is correct.
And it covers about 86, 87-odd percent, or even more,
that
last time I heard some of the guys talking about it, of the most popular ones that are in use.
That is correct. That
so
is correct.
Good broad coverage.
So the coverage we have chosen is, while we chose the coverage, we certainly kept the market share in mind, that what distributions have the majority of the mm-hmm. market share out there, and those are the distributions we support, and we are actively adding more.
So for these versions, integrated into the actual kernel themselves, no additional stuff needs to be done to make them to work as far as downloading something, because it's just built in. What sort of advantages do you have by running the Linux integration services on these particular distros? Like, what features do we have now?
That's a fantastic question. And as you can observe, you know, what can happen at times is that because there are so many distributions and each distribution has so many releases,
mm-hmm.
it just becomes complex to figure out what feature is there in which release, and therefore recently we have come up with some documentation which kind of maps out what features are available in which version of which distribution.
Okay.
And I'm going to show it to you in a moment. You know, let's just take a look at it here. So this is our recent documentation on for running Linux virtual machines on Hyper-V.
Okay.
And as you can see at the bottom, you know, that we have outlined the feature set for CentOS, Oracle, Red Hat, SUSE, Ubuntu. Now, if you just click on one of these links, what it takes you to is a page. And this page has, as you can see on the left side, it has all the features available. And in the second column, we have which Windows Server operating system version supports that given feature.
Okay.
And then we have, you know, which Red Hat version has which feature built in. So the tick marks represent that this feature is built into this Red Hat version.
Mm-hmm.
So similarly, you know, you can scroll through this list and take a look at different features we have. Similarly, we have a feature distribution map for SUSE. And as you can see, we have support for 11SP3, 11SP2, OpenSUSE 12.3.
Mm-hmm.
And then similarly, we have a distribution map for Ubuntu virtual machines. So we believe that users will find it very useful in determining what Linux version should they run when they are running Hyper-V. Mm-hmm. This will help them optimize their deployments.
Nice. How about you show me a little bit about what we've done? Can you do a little bit of a demo?
Sure, absolutely. But why don't we, let me start by giving you a little bit of an overview of what we have been doing for the last year and a half.
Okay.
Over the last year and a half, we have implemented several cool features for Linux integration services, particularly. We now have a 2D frame buffer driver, which allows you to take, which provides you better performance, better graphics performance, mm-hmm. on Linux desktop scenarios. We also have dynamic memory support. And dynamic memory support was much desired by our customers who want to improve their virtual machine density per mm-hmm. host. What that basically means is that if you're using virtual machines that are configured with dynamic memory, then you can host more virtual machines on the same Hyper-V host versus if you're using only virtual machines configured with static memory.
The hypervisor basically gets to choose how much memory is allocated to the VMs.
Precisely.
As opposed to the VM just dictating, I want this block, even though I'm only using a
small
bit.
That is true, yes, exactly, you got it. Now, we also have a very cool feature called VHDX Online Resize. Mm-hmm. So if you have a fixed-size VHD attached to a Linux virtual machine, you can actually now just go into the Hyper-V Manager console and just resize that VHD while it is mounted. And the Linux file systems are so cool that they can actually adapt dynamically mm-hmm. to this change in size. And I'm going to show this in a demo. Another much desired feature by our customers was support for synthetic fiber channel. Mm-hmm. And this feature actually provides Linux virtual machines the capability to natively access high-speed SAN networks.
Oh, okay.
So they don't need to do pass-through stuff anymore. The Linux virtual machine directly identifies a fiber channel device now.
Wow.
We also have another feature which was much desired by our customers was virtual machine live backup. Mm-hmm. So imagine you're running a Linux virtual machine and you want to take a backup of it. Now in previous releases, people had to shut down their Linux virtual machine or they had to take it offline or put it in a pause state, mm-hmm. but no more. So now you can do a live backup of a Linux virtual machine which is running, serving some server workload, and it will be backed up without any breakdown at all.
Okay.
And the last feature, which is kind of very unique, is the trim support, which we have recently added to one of the Ubuntu distributions, Ubuntu 13.10. And what this feature allows you to do is allocate storage on demand. So sometimes what people like to do, people anticipate is that, this virtual machine is going to consume a lot of disk space. So let me just give it a large volume, say 1 terabyte. But not all of that space is consumed upfront, mm-hmm. right? So what trim support allows you to do is that as you are writing to your storage, only that much storage gets allocated to what you have written to. Only that much storage gets allocated. So the advantage is huge in Azure type of scenarios where you are actually leasing storage space. Mm-hmm. But with trim support, you get charged only what you use.
Okay.
You don't get charged upfront for the 1 terabyte, but you only get charged for what you use.
All these features are things that I would just take for granted working with the Windows client. I didn't realize these were challenges in the Linux side of things until you were bringing them up.
That is true, and it has been, customers have been wanting it for quite some time, and mm-hmm. I'm really, really pleased with the stuff we have done over the last 1.5 years to bring Linux virtual machines to somewhat at par with Windows.
Okay.
Windows virtual machines. So without further ado, let me just go into a little bit of a demo mode for you guys. All right. So I'll start with a demo of the 2D frame buffer driver.
Yep.
And as you can see, I have two Linux virtual machines side by side. One of them is /11sp2, which doesn't have the frame buffer driver, and the other one is /11sp3, which has the frame buffer driver.
So now, on the left-hand side is basically non-accelerated, if you will.
That is correct.
And the right-hand side is going to be much better graphics
performance. Right.
Okay.
But I think graphics performance is sometimes difficult to measure, so I'm going to give you a more visual visual demo. So if you kind of rotate the mouse on this machine, you can see like the mouse is chasing a little dot.
Yep.
Right? That kind of indicates that you actually have an emulated device running. So this is /11sp2. It doesn't have our frame buffer driver.
Oh, okay.
So it is actually, the mouse is kind of chasing the dot. But if you switch Windows and you go into /11sp3, here the functionality is smooth. Mm. So there are no dots here. This is just, this has our frame buffer driver, and therefore, you know, you don't have that annoying dot here anymore.
My kids would call this lagginess.
Yeah, you could think of it that way. All right, so that was my little demo on the frame buffer driver.
Yep.
And now the next demo I'm going to go into is for doing how do you configure dynamic memory on Linux virtual machines. So I'll bring up my Hyper-V Manager console, and as you can see, you know, I have several Linux virtual machines running over here. One of these machines, OSTC Workshop 2, actually has an Apache web server built into it. And this virtual machine is configured with dynamic memory. As you can see, the startup memory over here is 768 MB. Mm-hmm. It is dynamic memory enabled. Minimum memory is configured to be 500 MB, and maximum memory is configured to be 8 GB.
Yep.
And as of now, it has 698 MB assigned to it. And as you can see, the memory demand is pretty low because the server is idling. It's not really doing anything. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to kickstart a web server workload on it, and we are going to see how the workload is going to scale by adding more memory to the system.
Oh, okay.
And so what I'm going to do is I'm going to start off the workload in the left window. And on the right window, what I have set up is a PuTTY console, which is kind of connected to the web server. Mm-hmm. And on the as you can see on this window is displaying the output of the free minus m command. As you can see, the total memory allocated to the system is just 736 MB,
yep.
out of which 324 is used, and you know, 4112 is empty, is not being used. So what we'll do is we'll start a web server workload on this VM, on this virtual machine, by saying, by triggering this command which I have written. And what we are going to see is that these numbers are going to start increasing. So the total memory available is going to start increasing beyond 736 MB. But also what we are going to see is that as the workload is increasing, the number of transactions that are being processed by the web server, they will stay constant.
Oh, okay. So yeah. It doesn't affect performance by having to expand the memory.
So there is a difference. So number of transactions will remain the same, but latency will start to grow.
Oh, okay.
Latency per transaction will start to grow. The average latency will start to grow. So you're right, in some sense, the throughput stays the same, but the latency becomes higher.
Okay.
So let's just kickstart the workload without further ado. And I'll just adjust the window a little bit. So as you can see on the left side, you can see the transactions per second. And now, as you can see, the memory has started to grow.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
So it's grown up to 1G, and then, you know, let's just give it a little bit of time. So as you can see, the transactions per second is 93, and latency will start to grow slowly. As you can see now, the amount of memory consumed is at 2G now.
Yep.
But as you can see, you know, latency has reached 102, but the amount of transactions is increasing. Is staying the same. Mm-hmm. So it's kind of scaling the workload by using dynamic memory. I think this is a great example of how you can leverage some of the dynamic memory infrastructure we have used. Okay, so also you can further see some proof to it by going into your Hyper-V Manager console again and see the startup memory was 768 MB, but and the maximum memory 8G, but the assigned memory has changed from some really low value to almost 4G in size.
Oh, okay. Yeah.
So that's sort of a great proof for it. So anyways, I'll terminate this workload for now, and we'll move on to some other interesting demos. So, you know, this was the demo for the dynamic memory part. Another great demo I can show you is how to do, live backup of a VM.
Okay. Yeah.
So if you remember that, you know, we had this VM which had our mouse pointer in it. Apologies, not this one. Let me just open up the VM.
There we go.
There you go. So this is a VM. It is running right now. Mm-hmm. It is running, it is functional, and we can play with it inside here. What I'm going to do is use Windows Server Backup to trigger a backup of this VM. So I'm going to use Windows Server Backup, and I'm going to schedule, I'll trigger a backup once.
So this is basically running on the hypervisor.
This is running on the hypervisor, exactly.
And in the past, this would not have been possible with the Linux integration services.
No. So what we are going to see is that as the backup is happening, this VM is going to stay alive. It's not going to go anywhere. So we will be able to, you know, kind of play with it while the backup is ongoing. So let me just go and see. So it is ready now, and I'll choose different options. I'll do a custom backup, and then I'll add items and select Hyper-V, and then select the VM which we want, which is, let me just see. Sorry, there are a bunch of VMs over here. So I'll take the SLE 11 SP3 VM and say next, and local drive, I'll select the P drive, and it's all ready, and then we click backup. And as it is backing up, so it is starting to back it up now.
Yep.
So we'll just give it a moment till it warms up and goes into the copying mode. And at that point, we'll switch back to the Hyper-V console and see what's going on over there. So the VM is being backed up, but at the same time, we can continue to play with it.
That definitely looks like it's still running to me.
Right. And also, as you can see, it shows backing up right here.
Oh, okay.
So it's giving you some status that it's actually backing up. So we'll leave it to itself because it's a 10 gigabyte VM. It's going to take a while to back it up, so I'll just leave it running.
Mm-hmm.
All right. So. And the last demo which I would like to show you is that how to resize
dynamic VHDX resize.
Right, exactly.
Yep.
So let's go back to our web server and look at some of the settings it has. So if you look at this web server, you can see that it has, just one moment. So if you look at this web server, we should see what settings it has. And if you look at the settings, it's just taking a little bit of time to open up, probably.
Here it comes. It's just finishing off the backup stuff.
Right, right, right. So let's just give it a moment. All right, there you go. So you have settings. And if you are looking at these settings, it has two drives for it. One is the hard drive, right? And the other one is, so I'll just reconnect the connection. So it is on. OK. One of them is the hard drive. The other one is a fixed size VHD, which is attached to it.
Mm-hmm.
So if you would, so as of now, let's see how much disk space does this VHD have. So I'll go back to our PuTTY window, and I'll terminate the free minus M command, and instead start a different command. And this tells us the size of the disk. Which is the fixed size, the size of the fixed size disk which is attached to this VM. And as you can see, it is about 1G in size. So what I'm going to do is kickstart another workload that is going to start filling up this disk.
Okay.
And as this disk is being filled up, I'm going to dynamically resize this disk. And we will see that the file system will automatically adapt to the change in size. So let's just start back without further ado. So we go here. And I'll start off a disk workload, which I have written, which will start to fill out this disk. OK, there you go. So it started now running. And as you can probably see, it has started to consume more disk space now. So as you can see, it's rising 45%, 46%, you know. Once it goes above the 50% threshold, what I'm going to do is turn around and start and go about increasing the size of the disk by using the Hyper-V UI.
Okay.
So now we are up 54%, 55%. OK. So now let's just go back to the Hyper-V console and expand the disk. So I'll assign it to 2 GB. So right now it's 1 GB, as you can see. And we'll go and assign it 2 GB. And then call finish. So it is editing the disk, and the disk is expanded to 2G. So as you can see, it's almost instantaneous, right?
Oh, wow.
So the size of the disk has changed to 2G from 1G, and the system has dynamically
adapted. There is nothing need to be done.
Nothing
at
that
the
needs
Linux
to
side.
Be done. There is, oh, yes, you're absolutely right. Good to point that out. So on the Linux side of things, we have written a little script which actually monitors the size of the disk in the background.
Mm-hmm.
And as soon as it sees that the size of the disk has increased, it actually issues a resize to fs command.
Oh, okay.
To live resize the file system.
But if you weren't running that script in the background, it would be a pretty simple thing to be able to do.
It would be, yeah, exactly.
You just automated it.
Exactly. And the reason we have gone this path is mostly because, you know, resizing a file system requires super user privileges.
Yeah.
And not everybody is comfortable sharing super user privileges with the Hyper-V administrator. So we have sort of left it to the user to design the policy,
but
we have provided a mechanism for it. All right, so that was the small demos I wanted to give to you.
Now, I got another question here for you, because you did some of the demos here, but I know that with Hyper-V, we also have, with the new 2012 R2 capabilities, we also have this new thing called Gen 2 VMs. Is that something that you guys have on your roadmap to be able to do with the Linux integration services?
That's a great question, and I'm very happy to announce that we actually have Generation 2 VM support for Linux virtual machines now.
Already. It's already in.
Already.
Okay, this
so
I gotta see.
Let's go back to my demo screen once more and take a look at this mystery VM we have, which I have put in. And this mystery VM is a recent installation of Red Hat 7, Red Hat Enterprise Linux 7.0. It's a beta, which is out there in the public domain. You can go to a Red Hat website and download it. And it comes pre-built with Generation 2 VM support.
Oh, wow.
So let's look at the settings of this mystery VM. So this mystery VM only has a SCSI controller hard drive. It has no IDE devices.
Right.
And you can actually go to the firmware part, and you can see that there it has an enabled secure boot.
Yeah.
We do not have the keys right now, so I won't be able to show you secure boot. But given the right keys, you can actually do a secure boot.
That definitely looks like with the few number of things that you have to worry about as far as devices are concerned on a Gen 2 VM.
Absolutely.
Gen 2 VM.
Absolutely.
And it's available now. You can look at it.
That's right.
Wow.
So what I'm going to do is, it's an off right now. It's an off state right now. So I'm just going to start and boot it up. And it's booting in secure mode.
Yeah, so you have
the
normal
right
adverts that come on.
Right. And let's just give it a minute so it boots up. And then I'm going to show you that our drivers are actually installed in this VM. So it's not just make-believe. It's actually working. OK, so we have the login now. And then I'm going to log in. Oh, sorry. All right, so if you can see, sorry about that. As you can see, it has all our Hyper-V drivers built into it. So everything is working. The support comes rebuilt. Red Hat is the first distribution to adopt the Generation 2 VM.
Mm-hmm.
And we'll actively continue to include the support into other distributions, such as Ubuntu, Slash, Debian, and Oracle.
Mm-hmm. Now, are there other things that we're also getting with that as well?
That is true. I would also like to mention that for a long time, we have been working on something known as virtual receive size scaling.
Oh, okay.
That is going to tremendously improve the networking performance for Linux virtual machines. And that feature has just gone upstream yesterday. So it will take some time to propagate it into different distributions, but that feature is also ready and will be coming in shortly.
Wow. It really is. All these different integration services now that are integrated into the different distributions, that opens up a whole new world of possibilities for performance.
That is true.
Right?
That is true. And we really hope that our customers are able to leverage them for running their Linux workloads.
Very cool. Now, you talked a little bit about some of the older distributions, that sort of stuff. So how about a little bit of a comparison? Because these are Linux integration services. They're integrated into the kernel now. And then I think you guys are referring to these as the 3.5 set. The 3.4 set.
Great.
Talk to me a little bit about those different versions and what the capabilities are.
So great news again. All these new features which we have implemented over the past one and a half year, we have backported them to older distributions.
Oh, okay.
And we are now shipping them as LIS 3.5. For our customers who already use LIS 3.4, they know what feature set we provide over there.
Mm-hmm.
But with LIS 3.5, we have further enhanced that feature set.
Oh, okay.
LIS 3.5 is a great improvement over LIS 3.4. Not only have we provided new features, but we have also expanded distribution support. So earlier, LIS 3.4 only supported RHEL 5.7 to 6.3.
Mm-hmm.
But with LIS 3.5, we are supporting 5.5, RHEL 5.5, 5.6, and then all the way to 6.3. Also, furthermore, we have added several new features on the storage side. For example, some of the features which we saw our demo for, VHDX resize, virtual fiber channel, live VM backup is also available in LIS 3.5.
Oh, wow.
Furthermore, we have also added goodies such as dynamic memory to LIS 3.5. We have also added our frame buffer driver, which provides better graphics performance in LS 3.5. And also we have added support for PAE kernels, as some of our customers had complained that PAE kernel support is not built in, so you guys might want to add it.
Oh, okay. How about, you've talked about all the good stuff that's there with being able to backport these back to older versions. Are there any other kind of gotchas or warnings that you want to talk about?
Yeah, absolutely. So one of the issues which we several of our customers report to us is that, hey, what's the deal with this protocol warning message, which periodically shows up? And this warning message is kind of almost makes looks makes things look really catastrophic. Like, we'll offer you, what this message typically says is that your protocol version of integration services does not match what Windows has to offer, and therefore no technical support will be offered to you unless you upgrade the integration services. Now, I just want to make sure that everybody gets it, that this warning is harmless. Just feel free to ignore it. We'll provide you all the technical support you need, irrespective of this message. It does not matter at all. It's an oversight, and we are working towards fixing it.
Oh, okay. Now, we've spent a lot of time talking about Linux integration services, and I also get asked a lot of questions specifically about FreeBSD. And so, do we cover everything, first of all, that you want to talk about on the Linux side?
Yeah,
so
absolutely.
FreeBSD side now, we can switch gears?
Yeah, absolutely. I'm very excited to talk about FreeBSD. Okay. Actually, it's a project very close to my heart. We have just finished integrating our first set of drivers into the FreeBSD kernel. They will be shipped with the FreeBSD 10 kernel coming January 2014.
Oh, wow. Great.
The FreeBSD ISO will contain these drivers, and customers do not have to download it from anywhere. When they will create a virtual machine, a FreeBSD virtual machine on Hyper-V, the drivers will be automatically installed in this virtual machine. Now, for older FreeBSD distributions, such as FreeBSD 9.1, we have standalone binaries, much in the style of our LIS 3.5 release.
Okay.
From where which customers can download and install on their FreeBSD system. We have now, instead of going to TechNet, these binaries along with their source code are available on our GitHub repository for FreeBSD.
Oh, okay.
So Microsoft is now maintaining a GitHub repository for FreeBSD. As of now, we have support for FreeBSD 9.1. We also have a little bit of work which was left out of the FreeBSD 10 kernel, so that is also being shipped as part of those binaries. And we'll be progressively adding more features and more distributions as we go forward.
Okay, very good. Now, how about the future? We talked about the future of the Linux side of things. What's coming up with the future of the BSD side?
Right. So as you can see, you know, the feature set of in our FreeBSD feature chart is quite kind of limiting. So right now, our feature set is relatively small. It's some of the core services, such as time synchronization, shutdown, network support, disk support, you know, things like that, which are basic but which are essential to run a virtual machine on Hyper-V. With time, we'll be adding more sophisticated features such as backup, you know, dynamic memory, some of the same stuff which we have added to Linux. So that is definitely one direction we are looking at. But also, there's a lot of interest in running FreeBSD-based appliances, particularly from appliances such as pfSense, router developers, and FreeNAS.
Oh yeah.
And we'll be working with those vendors actively in the future to make sure that our drivers are integrated into their distributions, and FreeBSD customers have as good as an experience as Windows Virtual Machines as well.
Very good. I'm familiar with the FreeNAS solution, so I'm interested to see where that goes.
Yeah.
Is there anything else you wanted to kind of wrap up, kind of like a go-to action, where they should go to for more information? Do you have any blogs you might want to refer them to, just as out of curiosity?
Right. I think the best point to start is our TechNet pages, where we have listed out, you know, what distributions are supported, what feature sets are supported. And if anybody of you has a question, you can directly reach me at my email address. And we also have various forums and various support groups for Linux integration services and FreeBSD integration services.
Very good. Well, keep up the good work and continue to do those comments on the blog posts about the Linux kernel and the integration services. That's where I managed to dig you up as a resource. I'm glad you took the time to come down and talk with us today. I really appreciate it. And thanks a lot.
Thank you. Thanks, Rick.
All right. Well, that is pretty cool stuff. The Linux integration team is just one nugget of all the stuff we're doing on our open source team here at Microsoft. So hopefully, you know, you liked that little nugget of wisdom from Rick here.
Yeah, very cool stuff. If you have any comments about this particular episode, feel free to leave them down below in the comment area. You're also welcome to send us a good old-fashioned email to edge@microsoft.com.
You can send us a tweet at TNEdge, and we want to hear from you. Let us know. What are some typical folks you want to see or things you want to know about in Microsoft that's up and coming? We'd love to hear from you.
Thanks a lot for joining us this episode, and we'll see you around next time.